My topic is the status and importance of trees in symbolism of ancient Indian art. And I would like to speak in Hindi because I am more comfortable with the language. If you don't mind, please. प्रकृति स्वाभाविक रूप से मानव जीवन की आदिम सहचरी रही है, जिसका स्पष्ट कारण है कि प्रकृति के कोख से ही मानवता का जन्म हुआ और प्रकृति के पालने में ही जितने भी मानव संस्कृतियां हैं उन सब का जो है विकास हुआ। आदिम युग में जबकि मानव का बौद्धिक विकास ना के बराबर था, अर्थात पशुओं तथा मानव में कोई भेद नहीं था, उस समय मानव अपनी मूलभूत आवश्यकताओं की पूर्ति के लिए पूरी तरह से एकदम से प्रकृति पर ही निर्भर था। तो बहुत साधारण सी बात हमको समझ लेनी चाहिए कि ऐसी अवस्था में मानव के मानव पटल पर जो सबसे अधिक प्रभाव पड़ना चाहिए वो स्वाभाविक रूप से प्रकृति का ही पड़ा। सहजता के लिए हमारी कला में वृक्ष वनस्पतियों के महत्व और विकास को कालक्रमानुसार हम समझ सकते हैं। इस क्रम में भारतीय संस्कृति के प्रथम अध्याय अर्थात हड़प्पा संस्कृति का उल्लेख करना चाहिए। अनेक पुरास्थलों से वृक्ष वनस्पतियों को प्रासंगिक करने वाले बहुत सारे मुद्रांक जिसे सीलिंग्स कहते हैं वो प्राप्त हुई हैं हमको, जिसमें सर्वाधिक मोहरे जो मिली हैं वो मोहनजोदड़ो से मिले जो 68% है लगभग। यहाँ वृक्ष पूजा के दो प्रकार प्रचलित थे लगभग, उसकी अगर सीलिंग्स का हम अध्ययन करें तो उसके दो प्रकार हमको वहाँ दिखाई पड़ते हैं। एक तो है जहाँ पर एक पूरी तरह से बिल्कुल सटीक वृक्ष की उपासना हमको दिखती है, और दूसरा होता है कि वृक्ष के आसपास कोई दैवी आकृति हमको दिखाई पड़ती है जिसकी उपासना का हमें साक्ष्य मिलता है। और इसी संदर्भ में एक विशेष शिवलिंग का हम उल्लेख करना चाहेंगे। अक्सर जनक दृष्टांत हमको मिलता है जहाँ पर एक सिर के बल खड़ी एक स्त्री हड़प्पा से ये शिवलिंग मिली है। सिर के बल उसको जो है उल्टा मतलब खड़ा करके दिखाया गया है और उसके योनि भाग से प्राइवेट पार्ट से वृक्ष बेल निकल रही है। तो अनेक इतिहासकारों ने कला इतिहासकारों ने दर्शन शास्त्रियों ने भी इस पर अध्ययन किया है, उन्होंने बताया कि ये वृक्ष और स्त्री इन दोनों की संयुक्त अभिव्यक्ति को दर्शाने वाली सीलिंग है, अर्थात दोनों में फर्टिलिटी पाई जाती है। अगर स्त्री का हम उल्लेख करते हैं इस कला के संदर्भ में या फिर दर्शन के संदर्भ में तो हम देखते हैं कि उसको एक फर्टिलिटी का एक सूचक माना जाता है, तो उसी तरह से वनस्पति को भी माना गया है। तो वो सीलिंग इम्पोर्टेंट है यहाँ पर इस चीज को उकेरने के लिए कि यहाँ से वो परंपरा की स्टार्टिंग होती है जो अर्ली मिडिवल एज तक चलती जाती है, जिसको हम अनेक मूर्तियों में अनेक स्थापत्य वास्तु शिल्प के हमारे अवशेषों में हमको प्राप्त होता है। इसके आगे जब हम बढ़ते हैं तो वैदिक जनों का काल आता है, वैदिक वाङ्मय का काल आता है। वहां पर हम देखते हैं कि भले ही वैदिक काल से कोई भी हमको स्पष्ट पुरातात्विक साक्ष्य इस तरह से ना मिले हों, लेकिन अगर उनके ग्रंथों का हम अध्ययन करें तो वहां देखते हैं कि उनका जुड़ाव प्रकृति से कहीं ज्यादा था। अगर इन कंपेरिजन दैट हड़प्पन सिविलाइजेशन उनका जो जुड़ाव था प्रकृति से कहीं ज्यादा था। उन्होंने देखा कि जो भी प्राकृतिक शक्तियां हैं जिनको भी उन्होंने देखा अपने चारों तरफ, कहीं पर बादल गरज रहे हैं, कहीं पर नदी जब बह रही है, कहीं पर वृक्ष दिखाई पड़ रहा है जहां से फल फूल निकल रहे हैं उनको उनके लिए उपयोगी है, तो उन्होंने उसमें देवत्वों का अधिरोपण कर दिया, उनको देवताओं के रूप में उन्होंने ले लिया। उन्होंने कहा कि ये हमारे देवता हैं, तो बहुत सारे हम देवताओं की जो एक हायरार्की पाते हैं वो नेचर के आधार पर ही पाते हैं। महाजनपद काल की अगर बात करें हम, जिसको छठी शताब्दी ईसा पूर्व का काल कहा जाता है, जो महात्मा बुद्ध के समय से स्टार्ट होता है, अगर उसकी बात करें तो यहाँ के पाटलिपुत्र, तक्षशिला, कौशाम्बी और भी बहुत सारे पुरास्थलों से बहुत सारे पाषाण चक्र मिले हैं हमको। पाषाण चक्र हैं, उनको योनि का प्रतीक माना गया है, जो कि जैसा कि मैंने पहले बताया फर्टिलिटी का प्रतीक है वो। तो वहां से पाषाण चक्रों पर बहुत सारी नारी आकृतियों को भी उकेरते हुए हम देखते हैं, और उसके साथ साथ उनके वृक्ष वनस्पतियों का भी उल्लेख और उनका जो है उत्कीर्ण वहां पर मिलता है हमको। मौर्यकालीन स्तर पर भी देखते हैं कि एकात्मक स्तंभों पर पशु पक्षियों की जो मूर्तियां मिली हैं उस पर बहुत सारे विवाद भी हुए हैं। इसके अलावा भी बहुत सारे नेचर की जो है मूर्तियां हमको मिलते हैं, टेराकोटा आपकी मिलती है, बहुत सारी जुमरड़ मूर्तियां वहां पर मिलती हैं, वहां दिखाई पड़ती हैं। एक सनाल पद्म, एक जो है मतलब नाल सहित जो एक कमल का पुष्प होता है उसकी भी मूर्तियां वहां पर हमको कई सारी दिखती हैं, और वहां माना गया कि महात्मा बुद्ध के जन्म का प्रतीक था, क्योंकि मौर्य काल में बौद्ध धर्म का बहुत व्यापक विस्तार हुआ था, तो माना गया कि ये बौद्ध धर्म का प्रभाव था कि यहाँ पर सनाल पद्म की इतनी सारी मूर्तियां हमको मिल रही है। इसके अलावा हम सातवाहन काल में आते हैं तो भरत स्तूप जो बगल में है और साथ ही महास्तूप पर भी बहुत सारे ऐसे वृक्ष बेलों का जो है अंकन हमको प्राप्त होता है जो उनकी इम्पोर्टेंस को दर्शाता है। इसी क्रम में एक जी सतीश भरहुत में एक जो है यक्ष की सहायता से वृक्ष पर आरोहण करने वाले एक स्त्री का हमको चित्रांकन वहां मिलता है। तो यहाँ पर उल्लेखनीय है कि कहीं कहीं पर यहाँ से एक नई टेंडेंसी स्टार्ट होती है कि वृक्ष को एक प्रेमी के रूप में और जो स्त्री है उसको एक प्रेमिका के रूप में दोनों को आलिंगन बद्ध मुद्रा में दिखाने की जो टेंडेंसी यहाँ से स्टार्ट हो रही है वो एक नया जो है संकल्पना हमारे भारतीय कला में आया। और इस तरह से हम देखते हैं बौद्धिकता के विकास के साथ ही मानव ने अपने मनोभाव संवेदनाओं को व्यक्त करने के लिए कुछ साधन खोजने का प्रयास किया। निर्विवाद रूप से कला ही वह प्रथम माध्यम था जिसके द्वारा मानव अपने मनोभाव को व्यक्त करके मानसिक संतुष्टि का आलिंगन कर सकता था। क्योंकि मानव का जीवन मूलतः प्रकृति से गहन रूप से प्रभावित हुआ था उसने वृक्ष वनस्पतियों के अंतर को अपने शिल्पांकन रूप के अभिव्यक्ति का सबसे महत्वपूर्ण आधार बनाया। प्रारंभ में तो उसने वृक्ष वनस्पतियों को ऐसे ही साधारण तरीके से दर्शाना प्रारंभ किया परंतु कालांतर में जैसे जैसे उसके मानसिक विकास में ज्यादा वृद्धि होती गई उसी क्रम में उसमें दार्शनिक चिंतन की भावना बलवती होती गई। इसी दार्शनिक चिंतन ने मानव की रचनात्मकता को गति प्रदान की। यही कारण था कि कालांतर में मानव ने अपने अत्यंत गूढ़ विश्लेषित दार्शनिक विचारों को अपने आदिम सहचरी प्रकृति के तत्वों वृक्ष वनस्पतियों के प्रतीक स्वरूप और शिल्पांकन के माध्यम से प्रस्तुत किया जिसका विश्लेषण हमने विगत अनुच्छेदों के अंतर्गत किया है। धन्यवाद सर। अगर कोई सुझाव आप लोग देना चाहें इस पर तो
in Chandali region, Odisha. In my exploration of the Chandali region in the district of Bhadrak, Odisha, I came across this image, Durga on a boat, near the village of Subhodia. And this Subhodia village is situated on the Subhodia river which ultimately connects to the Bay of Bengal. And the local people call that image Mother Kharakhai. This type of image of Durga is one of the rare images of Durga in Odisha vis-a-vis India. In Odisha context, a slab found near Rameshwar temple Bhubaneswar shows that 8th and Mahisha Mardini Durga 9th century AD is engaged in a fierce battle standing on a boat. The second image are there found in the district of Moyurbhanj. A sculptural panel in the early medieval temple of Goddess Ambika shows a boat wherein Goddess Ambika is seen seated. The size of this image is 24 inches into 18.5 into 18.5 inches. The upper portion of the image is highly damaged due to erosion. But the curvature and the pose of the figure definitely indicates towards its feminine character. A demon is seen obstructing the boat at the frontal part that is known as prow. In most Sanskrit textual accounts, Goddess Durga, like Tara in particular, is associated with ships and is conceived as a great savior who ensures the safe voyage for our devotees to the other shores. In the Brahma Vaivarta Purad, it is said, in the sea of the world, the Goddess Durga herself, like a dexterous pilot, takes over the worshippers of Krishna to the other side of the sea on the boat of divine faith. In the Durga Stotra inserted into the Virata Parva of Mahabharata, where it is stated that because thou rescuest people from difficulties when they are afflicted in the wilderness of or sinking in the great ocean, it is for thou are called Durga by all. Now, I come to the second section of my paper, that is on the boat. In any pre-industrial society from the upper Paleolithic to 19th century AD, a boat or later a seat was the largest and most complex machine produced. The water in the form of a pool, a river or sea has not only attracted but put a challenge before the human beings to cross over and developing our technology to overcome it from primitive days. In ancient Indian countries, there are limited archaeological evidences of a boat or scarcely a sri or the ship. In Odisha context, the pictorial depiction of means of water transport is disappointingly meager. The Lingaraj temple number one, there are 4 to 5, we can say, sculpture or panels or images where we can find boats. The Lingaraj temple of Bhubaneswar has a representation of a boat being steered with an oar by a woman dated to the 11th century sea. A sculpture from Konark in the 13th century sea shows a boat rowed by 4 people with a cabin in the center in which a man is seated armed with a bow and arrow. A boat depicted in the Sun temple of Konark contains a giraffe. Another 2 well-preserved reliefs in the Odisha dated about 11th-12th century featuring ceremonial barges with characteristically low forward with the stern considerably higher and showing the details of the flanking may be seen at the Bhogomandap Jagannath temple of Puri and also taken from Puri, Cape Cod Indian Museum, Calcutta. Almost all depictions of boats are not seaworthy. They are with a ceremonial barges, excepting one which I had discerned at Ratnagiri, Ashtar Mahamaya Tara, Cape Cod Ratnagiri. There is a ship with a mast. The paper I had presented at 70th session at Delhi, that is published in the proceedings. But this now we come to, because that depiction, it shows the mast, pro, etc. We can say with a sail also at Ratnagiri. That is the second kind of ship motif found in the eastern coast, one found at with the western coast. This boat resembles like the boat found in the reliefs 11th-12th century on the Bhogomandap of Jagannath Temple Puri and in the Indian Museum Calcutta. The stern of the boat is considerably very high in this image with a low forward indicating towards a ceremonial barge. It's not a ship, it is a ceremonial barge. However, in this image, the rudder at the stern is palpably visible. To the left of the slab and under the image of Durga, the boat is seen steered by the rudder man with a long handle. The boat is being rowed by many oars and we can notice 6 oars clearly. But the oarsmen have not been depicted on the boat. But the artist tries to give the impression that these oarsmen are rowing from inside of the boat. However, the detail of planking has not been depicted. The impression of the artist seems to show Durga in a Vishwarupa on a Ranatari. The other view also could be that the paucity of space forced the artist to place him under the her figure, which seems untenable. We can place the image in the 13th century AD. Thank you all.
Thank you. Good afternoon, my topic is Roots of Indian Martyrology Industry that is art, Guli, Sadistan. The term silicon in the context of the Hindu civilization must be broadly defined as an institution devoted to the world of deities. The princes of Greek art believed to be true by the evidence, but cannot be as a tool of this tool. Gods and the spiritual world and ideologies are part of the world of politics and economy. The rocks of the static area constitute part of the Vinson supergroup pertaining to the Mesoproterozoic time. The main Vinson basin lies in the central India, extending to the west up to the eastern part of Rajasthan. The Vindhya super blocks of Bundi district form the uppermost Bhande group of the upper Vindhya. The range consisting of a series of detailed hills varying from 300 to 1,700 feet above sea level, which is a distinguishing features of the country. It is indeed curious to note that the remains of Bundi prehistoric civilization do not expose any developed religious system like the Hindus who are by the religion. It is clear that religion was in practice here, but the people adopted this institution in a totally different way from the neighbor civilization. However, one of the main objects of worship of the people was Mother Goddess. The cult of the Divine Mother was widely prevalent. People believed in a female energy as the source of all creation. Along with this, a male god was also worshipped. Perhaps Lord Shiva was their chief god, as the figure of trident found in the rock art at Palkam Bundi. The representation of swastika and the wheels on some rock art and the terracotta figures of wheels found at various sites in the SS area make us believe that though actual worship of sun was not there, but it was represented symbolically. Some of the rock paintings illustrate the crude form of object worship. There is a primary shape of swastika also, which was later developed into its Vedic form, firstly introduced in the Bhimbetka rock painting. To its tuning in Bundi, it is found at Palkam, Garadda, Patishila, that the early man drew some superficial lines to bring out his object worship. Area-wise is painting, the rock art of the downstream area is not well preserved. These areas include Naldah, Chapalya, Undinal, Naldah, Nardah, along the river side. The rock arts in this low-lying area seems to be more developed as observed from the fineness of figures, complex line drawings, depiction of probable religious signatures, and figures related to the agricultural activities. The swastika is an equilateral cross with four arms bent at right angles. The earliest archaeological evidence of swastika shaped ornaments dates back to the Indus Valley civilization of ancient India as well as classical antiquity. Swastika have also been used in various other ancient civilizations around the world. It remains widely used in Indian religions, especially in Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism. Similarly, as a tantric symbol of above Shakti or the sacred symbol of auspiciousness, the word swastika comes from the Sanskrit swastika su, meaning good, asti, meaning to be, and ka as a suffix. The swastika literally means to be good. A category of composite animals such as Danegong, there is a peculiar rock painting at Kevalya exhibiting a gada similar to that of Lord Hanuman during the epic period. If one goes to the fact that the swastika of Rigveda was previously painted to the rock painting of Bhimbetka of near 1000 BC, then this fact is compared to the existence of gada in Bundi, that one may contemplate that the gada was worshipped as a symbol in the SS civilization. To add, it may be narrated that there are some of symbols which are have been practiced of worship through ages in Bundi zone and its vicinity, trident, imprinted horn, the sword, imprinted foot, etc. This official religion, with its zoomorphic spirit and separate people tree, obviously had roots in the naturalistic beliefs of earlier times. The beliefs were still of relevance in an age when dangerous wild animals could always be met within scrub and jungle that were never far away from the most habitations. The earlier beliefs must have been reinforced by a growing stock of mythology and symbolism orally transmitted through rock art.
Respected professors and research scholars, the topic of my presentation is Pandunath Devalaya, a historical perspective Pandu is a locality of Guwahati in Assam. The main attraction of the place is the Pandula temple, after which the place is believed to have been derived its name. The Pandula temple is situated on the south bank of river Brahmaputra and it is in a dilapidated condition. It is situated close to the Pandu railway station at the foot of the Varaha Hillock, which is a part of the Neelachal or Kamakhya Hills. Pandunath is a form of Sri Vishnu. Here, Vishnu in the name of Pandunath is worshipped. Ganesha is a part of Lord Vishnu. Legends related to Ganesha is attached with this Devalaya. During the years of incognito, the Pandavas and their mother stayed in Pandudham for a few days and offered puja to Pandunath and Ganesha. That is why worship of Ganesha is prevalent even today in Pandunath Devalaya. It is also believed that Pandavas worshipped Kamakhya after worshipping Pandunath and obtained blessings regarding their win in a war with the Kauravas, which eventually became true. The Naraka legend of Kamakhya has been connected also with Pandunath. In the 62nd chapter of Salika Purana, it is mentioned, Varaha Pandu Nathasya Thitastasya Hari Jasa Jaghane Shiroshi Krita Jaman Madhu Kaitava. The lines means that the two demons Madhu and Kaitava were killed by Madhava, that is Lord Vishnu, Lord Vishnu at the Varaha Hillock, which is situated to the east of the Bakshakuta Hillock. There is an interesting story behind the creation of Pandunath, and I would like to share the story with you all. Once upon a time, the world was full of water. Lord Vishnu was sleeping in the center of water. Devi Kamakhya wanted to create a new world. So she created two demons named Madhu and Kaitava from the dirt of Lord Vishnu's ear and ordered them to fight with Vishnu. In the meantime, Lord Brahma was created from the navel of Lord Vishnu and was sitting there. Both the demons rushed to eat Lord Brahma. Then Lord Brahma started to pray Kamakhya for rescue. Devi Kamakhya decided to save Brahma by awaking up Vishnu. So she lighted the water-filled world. Being awake, Lord Vishnu decided to save Brahma and started war with the demons. The war lasted for 5,000 years, but both sides failed to win. At last, being mesmerized by Goddess Kamakhya, the demons came to Vishnu and told that both of them are pleased to see his fighting tactics. So they wanted to grant Vishnu a wish. God Vishnu replied that he wants their death. Both the demons granted the wish, but with the condition that he cannot kill them in water. Listening this, Lord Brahma created a hill-shaped rock called Brahmasila in the water. Lord Vishnu started his fight with the demons over the rock, but the rock failed to bear the weight of the demons and Vishnu. Soon the rock started to sink. Lord Vishnu took the incarnation of Varaha and tried to keep the rock afloat but failed. Lord Brahma and Shiva too tried to keep the rock afloat. When three of them failed, Mahamaya Kamakhya helped them to keep the rock afloat. Vishnu killed both the demons and Kamakhya filled the watery world with flesh and fats. It is called man of the demons. Thus the world started to call Medini. After the war is over, a rock having the symbol of the thigh of Lord Vishnu appeared. This rock is known as Pandunath. Since that time, Lord Pandunath has been saving the worshippers of Vishnu. Thus, it can be said that the Naraka legend of Kamakhya is linked with Pandunath. Now, Now there is also reference of Pandunath in the 16th and 17th century Yogini Tantra. The Yogini Tantra says that Tree Lochan, that is Shiva.
Including.
So thus Pandunath temple is one of the most important place in Pandu along with Kamakhya for worshippers. It is one of the holy site of Pandu and all of Guwahati, and the place deserves serious attention in historical and also folklore research, because there are I think there are very few research done on the topic. Thank you.
Parvati Mukherjee says that her interest in a Shilpa Shastra like the Chitra Sutra of the Vishwamitra Puran is that it would aid an entry into the concerns that surround and inform our practice. So Chitra Sutra. The Vishwamitra Puran is an Up Puran, a supplement or appendix to the Vishnu Puran. Chapters 35 to 43 in its third khand constitute the Chitra Sutra, a treatise on painting, which is by far the most worked and most researched of all the Shilpa Shastras by pioneering art historians like Stella Kramrish, Anand Kumaraswamy and Shivrama Murthy. The best study is by Parvati Mukherjee, who also happens to be my supervisor, and she has used two more manuscripts from Nepal and Bangladesh to bring out a better and a more critical edition. On the basis of both internal and external evidence, she places it between circa 500 to 900 CE. The treatise admits that it is repeating and compiling from older sources. However, these sources being lost, it represents the earliest exhaustive account of the technique and theory of painting. So, representation of a Kshatriya figure. It says, I quote, "All kings should be made with the characteristics of great men." This indicates that there were figures who were respected, honored and held in high esteem as the great men. And I assume that these could be the sages, priests, teachers, warriors who sacrificed their lives in battles, or other exemplary figures of socio-economic, political, cultural or ritual importance. Elsewhere it says, "In a painting, kings should be made just like gods." And it pays thorough attention on the portrayal of a god. I quote, "They should be decorated with crowns, earrings, necklaces, armlets and bracelets. They should be portrayed wearing beautiful garlands and an elaborate girdle, foot ornaments, sacred thread and ear ornaments." I'm skipping the Sanskrit terms here. Throughout this treatise, which is a dialogue between sage Markandeya and ruler Vajra, the sage refers to Vajra as by these epithets like, "O Lord, O best of men, O tiger amongst men, O Lord of men, O best among men, O learned men," which are indicative of the elevated rank and superior position of the Kshatriyas, as can be inferred in the rhetorical mode of Markandeya. A particular reference is interesting. It says, "O long-armed one." It cannot be said with certainty if this reference is in the context of a desirable attribute of a king, or it is particularly referring to other physical corporeal trait of Vajra. Now, the salience of beauty in the representation of a king. It says, and I quote, "Kings should be made with feet and hands webbed, and in the middle of their eyebrows there should be a tuft of hair. Hair should be beautiful wavy, beautified with natural oil, resembling a jar of fire." Now the beauty even extends to the lines of a palm of a king. I quote, "Three beautiful lines, finely tapered, should be made on the palms of kings." Now I argue that this is a kind of politics of representation, because the sage is assigning certain special attributes and elements in the portrayal of a Kshatriya figure, because he is narrating the rules of painting to a ruler himself. So I argue that it could be a more effective, efficient and efficacious means to captivate his attention to the rules of painting by making the depiction of a king in a chitra, that is painting, more detailed, more fascinating, and more special. I conclude. In this attempt to understand and underscore the depiction of a kingly figure, the text also underlines the nature, drive, and approach of pictorial representation drawn from and contingent on the concept and the determinant of caste. The ideal of aesthetics is amply foregrounded in their representation to the extent that there is an emphasis on beauty even in the palms of a king. It seems like an expression of the quality of life of a king through the medium of Shilp and the myriad possibilities of bringing out the aesthetic vividness and charm in such a representation. Now, when it says that a king should be shown just like a god and then going to some detail for in depiction of a god, we see a king being equated with a god. Now, the portrayal of a king embodies and exhibits a very refined notion of beauty, which marks a significant and noteworthy departure from the rendition of other varnas such as Brahmanas, Kshatriyas and Shudras. There is a separate, distinct, special model of beauty in the Chitra Sutra for a king that also gives a glimpse of social hierarchy and difference. Thank you.
Krishna is the presence of divinity in Jainism, exploring the art and literature. This paper is an attempt to trace the assimilation of Brahminical deities in Jaina tradition and also to locate if there is any similarity or differences into the role of deities as described in literature or depicted in temple art. Jainism rejects the hypothesis that an eternal self-substance God made the world. According to the Jaina view, the physical world is ruled by the physical world and not by the divine world. If the fire burns and water flows, it is not due to the will of God, it is due to their inherent quality. So, let's begin with the literature, like the way divinity is given in Jaina literature. It is given in the Shastra Rakavish that the temple, that the empire of Spain is present even among the gods, where they are destroyed by the sorrow, anger, jealousy, and seeing the palaces of women, jewels, garlands, and burned by the flame of averaging jealousy. So the basic difference between God and Tirthankar as given in the Jaina literature are that the Tirthankars are free from the bondage of karma. They escape the cycle of rebirth, but the God must be born again and again as mortal. The another example given in the Shastra Rakavish is that where God is projected as subordinate to the Tirthankars, and I quote, with a gracious mind, Satriya went to the master presence at the mere sight of the Lord Tirthankar, the Lord of God, for the sight of master, opposed the first present, then after the circumambulation, the blessed one and his mother. Satya both again in the Jaina. So here it is clear that the Satya, the God of Gods, was somehow paying homage to. It is represented as paying homage to the Tirthankar. So they are kept on the subordinately position to the Tirthankars. And gods are considered as devas, where the Tirthankars are called deva adhideva, as given in the Shastra Rakavish. After seeing the difference between gods and Tirthankars, we find that after finding in literature that gods are described as subordinate to Tirthankars. We find in temple art that the myth of Krishna, Vishnu, Narayan, Narasimha are well depicted on the temple art of Jaina temples.
Please summarize.
Various Vishnu incarnations in Jaya temple, various scholars such as Jaya Tharga observed that the Oshya was the center of worship of Vishnu. Nearly one third portion of Sashyamala temple of Oshya was devoted to various forms of Vishnu, and the door frame of one of the Vishnu temples within Sashyamala complex labeled by the Handa as the Vishnu temple. In this regard, I would like to say that the Jivanta Swami Pratima in Mahavira temple is situated at the entrance of the Mahavira temple is very much resembled to the Vishwarupa form of Vishnu, and we find. We find various Nagapasha images of Krishna in Sashyamala temple as well as Mahavira temple in Oshya, which are well depicted in Harihara temples.
The title of my paper is "Their Basic Quest for Salvation: Study of Inscriptions of Early Medieval India." Their basic appears as an integral category of donators to be noticed, donating lamps, various gifts and land grants to the temples during early medieval period in India. There is no denying the fact that Devadasi is related to God in persona. She is a female whose powers are ritually merged with those of the goddesses, and secondly, because she is dedicated to a divine husband, thus she is a mistress mandali. In the epigraphs of early medieval India, her identity comes out as a donor or grantor of land, which she is receiving mostly being a part of the temple. Her reasons of donations have not been considered different by historians, and putting Devadasi amongst the rest of the categories of female is unjustified. When rest of the female lords of the society was making such donations to increase their religious spirit in the existing world, a Devadasi who herself was a part of temple and already standing on high pedestal, donations of all her material possessions to the temple itself raises a curiosity. Argument put forth in this paper is that the dilemma of salvation was haunting her psyche and led her to donate whatever she possessed. The salvation or spiritual liberation of women has been a matter of great controversy and of abiding interest among all the major sects existing in Indian society. Certainly, women in early medieval India could not remain unaffected by religious waves of the changing. The process of donations gained impetus, and Devadasi was certainly a beneficiary to such grants, which is corroborated by several epigraphs. Such donations are being made to mark her identity associated with temple and God. As a show of her religiosity, people not only donated land to the temples but to Devadasi as well. She received number of grants in temple in the form of land, mostly depending on her ranks in the service of God. A Devadasi was attached to temple of her native place, and seldom perhaps she was transferring to the land to the native temple also. The study shows that the gifts donated by temple women are no different than that donated by rest of the female section, whether the donor is a queen, palace women, common female or a Devadasi. The point of difference is that the rest of the females are donating to a temple, while Devadasi, who herself is a part of temple, why she is making such donations. Aloka Prashasan has categorized temple land grants in respect of temple girls under four categories, and in these four categories, first category was of those temple girls who made endowments to the temple, implying their access to property which they could dispose of in the manner that pleased them. The early medieval period was full of religious activities where female Shaiva and Vaishnava sects were inspiring the women section towards a different kind of devotion. Devadasi could not remain unaffected by these ways because these female saints, who also identified themselves with gods by singing, dancing and reciting poetry. Bhakti movement, by throwing open the path of salvation to all irrespective of caste and social hierarchy, imbibed the ideal of non-orthodox creeds namely birth and caste, as no obstacle to the salvation. Then Dasi had every opportunity to identify herself with these states, but her identity towards temple deity allowed her to carve mission into the existing temple system only. Her rights of getting grants and donating them freely were different from the rest of the women. Aloka Pressure Sen has aptly stated, in contrast to sisters and wives and widows in the above example, who got land either through gifts or inheritance, temple girls distinctly received land grants for their skill in the religious functions and duties they performed in their temple. Influence of Bhakti movement went up to certain extent, promoted her us to look for ultimate salvation. That is how she is donating what she gained for her service to the temple. Moreover, she could equate herself with the rest of the female lord who donated to increase their religious merit. This fact is clear when we notice that the language of most of the inscriptions is same irrespective of the fact who the donor is. Another argument put forth in this, in her place in the temple under category of Anubhoga and Ranbhoga, where she has been acknowledged as the object of dedication to the temple. In both the cases, her position was of a performer, not of a devotee to God who deserves high respect. It was hard for Hindu law courts to find any solution to the problem of salvation for women except horrible practice of sati. They thus was neither a married woman in true sense of the term to some human form called husband, nor she was reminiscence of her husband like a Hindu widow, for whom she was under one sulfiness for reunion in the heaven. Salvation to Hindu women was her house and husband. Here for their dasi, her house was a temple that never belonged to her, and salvation for or through husband was nowhere in existence. Mr. Kantoni. Certainly, though entered into temple as a daughter or devotee, but neither she was holding a powerful position to justify her status as a temple administrator, nor she had any means of attaining salvation. She was a different devotee of God who was personally attached to God in absentia. Her identity sometimes as a temple commodity or just as a showcase dancer or singer kept disturbing her. The rest of the people of the society, it was obvious that to showcase their religiosity, donating to temple was an easy way, but for a female who was a part of temple, her matter of salvation nowhere arose. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, Unadar, respected Chair, Ron Scholars, others. My paper will discuss on Thirumalai inscription, a Jain inscription of Vidukattai Lagiya Chera Perumal, a new light on the Perumals of Kerala. The study is mainly based on a single inscription. So it's a huge paper, but I can read the gist of this paper within a few minutes. The present study is represented an attempt to shed fresh light into the dark corners of the history of the Cheras, the well-known native ruling family of ancient and medieval Kerala. This inscriptional analysis could be a landmark in the history of Jainism in Kerala as well, on account of it crucially connecting the faith of Lord Jina with the Kerala Putras. It is mainly based on a medieval epigraph of a king named Vidukattalagiya Perumal, incised on the outer wall of the entrance which leads to the famous painted Jain cave on the Thirumalai Hill near Porur in Tamil Nadu. Even though this record was published in the later part of the 19th century, it is identified for the first time by the present researcher as a vital source for the reconstruction of the history of Cheras as well as the history of Jainism in Kerala. Corroborating it with some other inscriptional as well as literary evidences, it can set forth a postulation that the ancient Cheras and the Perumals of Kerala or the later Cheras were belonging to the same line of ruling family. Although this record was roughly assigned to 11th century common era on paleographic grounds by some epigraphists, on the basis of some other records speak about the contemporaneity of the king Vidukattalagiya Chera Perumal with the Chola king Kulothunga III, it has to be assigned to 12th or 13th century common era. The core content of the records says that Vidukattalagiya Perumal, son of one Rajaraja, repaired and saved from the ruin the image of a Yakshi and Yaksha, along with a gove and a channel of the Arthur temple on the Thirumalai mountain, which was set up by the very pious-minded Chera Kerala king of Vanchi named Elini or Yavaniga. Three rulers of the Chera race, Elini or Yavaniga, Rajaraja or Vagan, and Vidukattalagiya Perumal or Vyamukta Sarvajnala is mentioned in this inscription. Vidukattalagiya Perumal was the son of Rajaraja and their forefather was Elini or Yavaniga. Elini or Yavaniga is described as the Chera ruler of Kerala whose capital was at Vanchi. Rajaraja or wagon is described as the prince who was the ornament of Yavaliya's rise, the foremost of the right path who came Yavaliya's rise after the later had died. The term Vidugadalagya Perumal means the Perumal whose abode is at sea, and the surname Perumal affixed with the line of further establish his place in the line of Perumals of Mahodebura. At the present state of our knowledge, there are no inscriptions of later Chera rulers after Rama Gulashekara. The present inscription under discussion must be belonging to the post Rama Gulashekara period. Some inscriptions from Salem and the Tiruvannamalai regions of Tamil Nadu refers the names of Kulothunga Chola III and the Vidugadalagya Perumal together, which help us to reach the conclusion that he was a Chola feudatory. At the same time, identification of his eulogy inscription from the western Govinda of Guruvayur temple in Kerala confirmed his political authority over his motherland. The same laudatory was without any changes found on the northern Pragana wall of the Ilingoleshwaram temple in the village Ladigam in Andhra Pradesh may be identified to indicate the extension of this political authority beyond Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Both the Ladigam and the Guruvayur record further stated that he was the jewel of the Kerala Vamsha. On the basis of all this evidence, it seems safe to identify Vidugadalagya Perumal as the last Chera Perumal as well as the immediate successor of Rama Gulashekara. However, initially Vidugadalagya Perumal might have ruled from Tagadur as an Idiyaman chief, and then after Rama Gulashekara, either his death or abdication of throne, his sovereignty might have extended to the Kerala region too. Yelini and Rajaraja also held the title Adigaman or Adigan or Adigantrika. Vidugadalagya Perumal is described as the lord or protector of the Tagana or Tagadiya. Tirumala inscription also titled him as Chera Adigan Tiru Neduman Tiru Tadagada Veeran. The war described in the Puranaruru and the Tagadur Yathirai, which fought between the Irumurai line of Chera rulers and the Adiyaman chief Neduman, and he proves the existence of Adiyaman chiefs of Tagadur as one of the collateral branches of the Chera ruling family. At the same time, some studies show that Irumurai line of Chera, so Karur in Tamil Nadu, was the offshoot of the other line of rulers who ruled from Vanji in Kerala. However, the Elini in the Tirumala record must be belonging to the ancient other layer of Chera rulers, because according to the inscription, he was the Chera ruler from his capital to Vanji. The Rajaraja Ali's wagon, father of Vidugadalagya Perumal, can be identified as Rajaraja Ali's Devi Rama Rajaditya Ali's Aditya Koda Ranaditya, who belonged to the main line of Chera Perumal family ruling from Tiruvanthikulam. He must be identical with the Ire Raja Ali's Rajaraja in the Tiruvanthur Jain inscription discovered from the vicinity of Kozhikode city. Another two native records, one from Tichambaram and another from Indiyandur in Manapuram, mentioned his name. Two Chola records from Manarkoil in Tamil Nadu mentioned his ruler as Chera Manna Rajaraja Deva. Most probably he was succeeded by the last Chera Perumal, Rama Gulashekara of Mahodeyapuram. At the present state of our knowledge, the relationship between Rama Gulashekara and the Rajaraja is unknown. Possibly he was a brother or son of Rajaraja Chera. Probably Rajaraja's kingdom would have comprised the geographical territory of the present Kerala and some Tamil region, including Tirunelveli, Coimbatore and Salem. Another name, Elini or Yavaliya, supposed to be titled, this is a special discussion in our study. Here it is reasonable to assume that the Chera king Yavaliya had a Yavana touch. Yavaliya in the Tirumala inscription could be a title of the king Elini on account of either he overpowered the Yavanas or got protected by the Yavana soldiers. There is another supposition that Yavana colonies were protected by the Chera king. The presence of Yavanas in this region is referred to in the Tamil classics such as the Padachupasu and the Silapadikaram, which account largely with the king Chera Chingu. He was the protector of the Yavanas, he overpowered the Yavanas, presence of the Yavanas in the army, the presence of Yavana Trades colony in the Tavalani, etc. To be concluded, Elini in the Yavaniga, a Chera monarch of Vanji in Kerala described in the record, can be identified as the ancient Chera king Kadal Pidagopia, Chera Chungutwan, illustrated in the Tamil classics. Rajaraja, father of Vidugadalagya Chera Perumal, in the record can be identified as one among the Perumals of Kerala rulers, Devi Rama Ranaditya, alias Aditya Koda Ranaditya, who belonged to the main line of the Chera family ranked from Tiruvanthikulam. Vidugadalagya Perumal can be identified as one of the Adigaman chief of the Tagadur, can further be proved that the Tagadur chiefs also belong to the Chera line of ruling family. Moreover, Vidugadalagya Perumal can also be identified as the last Chera Perumal. Then they already identified Rama Gulashekara by some historians like MGS, but the former's capital was at Tagadur and his kingdom extended beyond the geographical territory of Kerala and even Tamil Nadu. Yelini, the Yavaniga, alias Yakutan, was a worshipper of Yaksha and Yakshi, substantiating the prevalence of Yaksha and Yakshi cult in Tamilagam, including the present Kerala, even during the Sangam age. The Tiruvannur inscription reveals the importance given by King Rajaraja for keeping the noble faith alive in the medieval Kerala country. The royal decree recorded in the Tiruvannur inscription has to be measured as an unsuccessful attempt to protect its vanishing faith by a Chera ruler governing from Mahodeyapura. The Tirumala record is sufficient enough to comprehend Vidugadalagya Perumal's positive attitude towards Jainism. the huge chehra now Instagram on the top of the large and Jain temple further reveals his encouraging attitude towards Jain's faith. Thank you. I am Rohan
Allen,
PhD
research scholar, Balaji University, Chennai. Respected Chairperson, Leonard Professor, and delegates of good afternoon to everyone. I am going to present a paper entitled Konvilanga Kalthur as Green from the epitaph of Munkulishwara Temple. The village Konvilanga Kalthur is located in Kanchipuram district, formerly interrupted with Chengalpattu region. It forms a part of Tondai Mandalam. Kalathur seems to have been the headquarters of Kalathur Nadu and Kalathur Kottam. Etymologically, this place name Konvilanga Kalthur has been derived as one place where the best Kalathur. Kon denotes gold. Vilainda means arrested or robbed, and Kalam plus wood bear several meanings. Place, place, locality, open space area, place in power, place for trading grain, assembly, meetings, court, theater, hall of sacrifice, battlefield, selling field. However, Tamil lexicon gives the following meaning for the term Kalam. That is sound, blackness, white rock, poison, and varnam. Gold means settlement. The settlement where gold was arrested. It is to be noted that gold was arrested in the field. Since there is no gold mine here, they would have arrested the quarry which have shined like gold. The village is emblazoned with the three important temples such as Lakshmi Narasimha Temple, Sri Munkulishwara Temple, and the third one Panjali Amman Dharmaraja Temple. However, Munkulishwara seems to be the oldest temple in the village, with the 21 lithic records of this one to Pallava Nandivarman III, 15 are assigned to the Cholas, 4 to the Pandyas, 1 to the Vijayakantapopala. These records refer to the endowment of land, money and land, and interesting is revealed from the epigraph as new Devadana village was also created. Land was endowed as Tirunamurthi Kani and Kaval Kani. The image of Sestra Bala and Chandreshwara were consecrated beside the sign for the gods was constructed by Arulala Perumal for the merit of his mother. During the region of Pandyas, three brothers donated land for offering to the deity, and the name of the village has been changed as Ganaikonda Chalasadravedi Mangalam. Purandi Flower, who composed an Alavanpa, and the Kurvan Ayanar were hailed from this village. Above all, it served as the headquarters of the Kottam, that is Kalathur Kottam. It was one of the mercantile cities during the medieval period, attracted endowments, but now it has shrunk to a small village in Chengalpattu district. Thank you.
Hey everybody, I am Dr. Kalyani, from Bharati College, Chennai, Monadnet. I am going to present a paper on the Tirukalikundram. And this Tirukalikundram is one of the ancient village in Chengalpattu region. Now it has become a very easily accessible place in Kanchipuram district. We can easily access to from Chennai, Chengalpattu, and Madurai. And this Tirukalikundram is called by various names, Veda Greetings, and Pakshi Tirtham, Dakshina Kailasam, Rudra Kotai. And the entire hill is called as Veda Hill because the Vedas have recited in the hill, and it was heard by the kites. So the kites used to come around the 12 moon in the every day of the afternoon, but now this kites are not coming now. But still, this name remains as Tirukalikundram. And there are three temples in the village. One is Moolasthana Muraya, and another one is the cave temple. Third one is located at the bottom of the hill. And two temples are assigned to the Saiva cult, and one assigned to the Vaishnava cult. And this place was a settlement of the Chinas. There are many names related to the Jains, Amanam Pakam and Amanam Pandi. And the Neminada Adikal is also found in the epigraph. It is to be noted here that there are nearly 98 inscriptions in the three temples.
of these 30 epigraphs speak about the endowment of land for these various purposes to the deity. So mainly these lands were endowed for the maintenance of the mata, burning of our lamp, and the services to be conducted in the temple for the performance of festivals in the temple, and also construction. It speaks about the construction of shrines and temple. The name of the constructor or the builder is also given in the epigraphs, and the everyday pujas were also mentioned in the inscriptions in detailed manner. And these epigraphs are recorded right from the period of the Pallavas down to the period of the Vijayakanda Gopala, that is the Telugu Cholas. And with regard to the land endowment, one interesting record speaks that the stone inscription was also engraved on the copper plate ground. So this was done by Rajendra Chola, and both the stone inscription as well as the copper plate grant are engraved in Tamil script, and it gives the detailed information about the endowment of the village, Devadana village, the boundary, and the signatories of the inscription is also given in the epigraph. And it is to be noted here that the value of money has also depleted. When the Pallavas they granted the land, it was only 5 paso. During the Chola period, usually increased to 500 panam. So, this is one of the interesting epigraph from the temple. And three inscriptions speak about the time and death in the temple. So, two inscriptions speak about the murder of persons, and they were punished by burning a lamp in the temple. And one death was noted, and he stolen the Tirupattam of the deity, and his properties were confiscated by the temple authorities, and he was evacuated from the village. This is also one of the interesting incidents noted from the epigraphs of Tirupal Kundram. This was also a mercantile city, and also this was one of the Jaina settlement in Jindalpatta region. So we have sufficient information from the epigraphs with regard to its political history, socio-economic and cultural aspects. Thank you.
Chairperson, good afternoon to one and all. I am Dr. B. Dharani from Bard Women's College. My topic is Medicine in Tirukural, the Universal Veda of Tamil Literature. Tirukural is one of the great work and masterpiece of Tamil literature, supposed to be written 2500 years ago, one of the highest and purest expression of human thought according to the 19th century French translator Maurice Ariel. It was written by poet Saint Thiruvalluvar, who lived in Mayapur, Chennai. The completion consists of three major divisions: virtue, wealth, pleasure, under 133 headings, each having 10 couplets totaling 1330. In the second division, the poet explains health care in 10 couplets under the heading medicine. In this couplet, he mentions the nature of human body, constitution, food, timing, and qualities of medical practitioner. It is astonishing to note how the poet could delve into these minute details in that period that are researched and published by present-day scientists using modern gadgets and experiments with living models. Tirukural, or simply Kural, deals with everyday virtues of an individual. It belongs to 300 BC to the 7th century. The traditional accounts describe it as the last work of the third Tamil Sangam. The Kural emphasizes on the virtue principles of non-violence, moral, vegetarianism, human brotherhood, absence of desire, path of righteousness, etc. The traditional medicine. The country that possesses age-old civilization and culture have contributed to our medical system also. They have developed their own medical theories known as indigenous medicines that are generally based on religious, socio-cultural ethos. As there is no proper medium to record the findings and experience, the practitioner passed down them to the next generation by word of mouth, usually from the elders to the medical family of the younger one.
There is a vast difference of opinion about the early beginning of medical science and also its founders. Some consider the Indians were the pioneer, while others view that it were Egyptians or the Greeks. The study of history reveals that the science of medicine was brought up in the laps of spiritual personalities, their inspiration and dreams have caused enlightenment in human minds. The history of medicine in India can be traced to the remote past. Evidence for the well-organized system of medicine in India can be obtained from the archaeological remains of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro. In the Indus Valley civilization, a system of medicine provided which the drugs from vegetable, animal and mineral origins were used. The 7th century AD Huang Zhang, who came to India during the period of Gupta, made elaborate observations and mentioned few names of fruits like Amla, Madhuka, Bhadra, Makusha and Pasana, which are used for medicinal purposes. Archaeological evidences are available to show that ancient civilization made use of different medical plants. The finding of carbonized seed of gooseberry at Navajoliti in Madhya Pradesh dating back to 1600 BC confirms this. The two systems that developed in India is Ayurveda and Siddha, Ayurveda in the north and Siddha in the south. Similarly, the Tamil inhabitants of the peninsula of India had a hoary past of that of the Egyptians, and the Siddha medicine has a background of mythology and its genealogy of the teachers are little different from Ayurveda. And in this system, the first founder is Lord Shiva as against Brahma in Ayurveda. Lord Shiva communicated this to goddesses Parvati, and she in turn transmitted to Nandideva, and he in turn gave it to Agatya, who is considered to be one of the Siddhas of the age. So finally, the Thiruvalluvar, considered to be the 19th saint, he describes from 941 to 950 the Quran. The first, the learned books count three, with the wind as first of these, as anyone prevail or fail, will cause disease. That is, inattention or excess food consumption or activity lead to disease due to imbalance of three tumors, Vada, Pitta and Kapha, corresponding to the modern equivalents of wetness, bitterness and filler. No need of medicine to heal your body's pain if you know what you ate before digested well, you eat again. Who has a body gain may long the gift retain, if food digested well is better, do he eat again. If one digested, let one eat with moderation, that is the way to prolong the life of embodied soul. Assure yourself that your food has been digested and never fail to eat, whenever hunger, whatever is not disagreeable. Next, there will be no disaster to one's life if one eats with moderation food that is not disagreeable. As pleasure dwells with him who eats moderately, so disease with the gluttan who eats recklessly. He will be acquainted with the numerous disease who eats immoderately, ignorant of the rules of care. Last one, Mahatma. In the above 7th couplet, Thiruvalluvar explained how a common man can prevent himself from the diseases, and in the next 3, about the physician, let the physician inquire into the nature of the disease, its cause and the methods of the cure, and treat it faithfully according to medical rule. The learner should ascertain the condition of the patient, the nature of the disease and the season, and then proceed with the treatment. Medical science consists of 4 parts, patient, physician, medicine and composer. Each of these are interrelated with one. So finally, it is said that from the ongoing discussion, it is understood that even before 2005 in the year, the concept of medicine was well understood in Tamil soil. It is pretty much to mention that food and water intake and the preventive aspects of diseases are advocated by the modern science only in the recent years, which has been formed already in our ancient India. Thank you.
Charms and incantations were used not only for healing purposes and providing remedies for the major and minor diseases, but also dealing with other kinds of difficulties one faced in life. They completely relied upon the fact that diseases or even any sort of unhappiness that disturbed someone's daily life were brought about by an external factor such as a demonic being or a malignant spirit. Such spirits were said to be unhappy with the victims who were suffering. In certain cases, dissatisfaction of particular deities was thought to be the cause, as a result of which they were offered prayers, invoked and worshipped to seek remedies. Certain esoteric words and phrases became an integral part of the remedial measure, along with the magical ritualistic and religious rituals which were performed. The magical healers helped the people to recover from a disorder or cope up with a difficult situation in life. The text does not derive its name from the nature of its contents, but rather from the word Atharvan, which meant a fire priest who was said to have been the first priest who rubbed fire and communicated between the gods and the men. This text has often been referred to as the Atharva Angirakshana, a compound form of the names of two ancient families of priests, the Atharvans and Angirakshas. Dates of the text are debatable, but it's said to have been compiled around 1200 to 1000 BC. Varied perspectives on the text. All the scholars trying to understand the antecedents to the later rational medical literature have dived into the details of studying the Vedic literature. First work that I would like to note is by Dominic Bujalstik. In his work, The Science of Medicine, he has mentioned that Ayurveda evolved organically from the medical traditions that were integral to the earlier Vedic literature. It is true that there are preliminary descriptions about the human body parts and identification of certain diseases along with identifying their symptoms in some of the verses of the Atharva Veda. However, such verses remain scattered throughout the text. Kenneth Jesus, in his work Religious Healing in the Veda, suggested that diseases during the Vedic period were given emphasis on the basis of a dangerous spirit or a demonic being that was supposed to have been the cause, and remedies given were certain charms or sacred utterances along with performance of rituals if necessary, and also use of different plant parts as amulets or talismans. Amulets of gold and pearl were recommended to attain long life. Prayers were offered to Vedic deities so that their blessings would help one stay healthy and happy. In certain cases, special prayers accompanied with certain incantations and rituals were performed by a particular deity or set of deities, who were thought to have been angry, and as a result of which, the adverse effect on an individual was an ailment faced by the person. In many cases where the diseases were thought to have been caused by an external force or a spirit, the healer or the Bhishat Atharvan, who was the magical healer, played a significant role. If the rituals were properly performed at the designated auspicious time and place mentioned in the text, the healer was to obtain the power necessary to get rid of the evil spirit causing the disease to a faraway place from the patient's house. Certain legends divinize particular herbs and plants which were employed in the rituals, therefore making them more efficacious. K.T. Upadhyay in his work discussed how various gods and goddesses came to be associated with different trees and plants and were started being worshipped. Both the sentiments of adoration and fear prevailed simultaneously. Filioza, in his work on the classical doctrine of Indian medicine, suggested that therapeutics in the Vedic period was essentially in the form of incantations and magical practices. Majority of curative charms are formulae of exorcism irrespective of the fact whether the disease aimed at is presented as being caused by the action of a demon or not. Magic and environment were the two most important elements that were relied upon by the Vedic people. They hardly attributed the diseases to any rational or physiological causes. In the Atharva Veda, the hymns on medicine are quite scattered and the arithmetic does not follow any specific way of dealing with the things. Therefore, in order to make this paper more comprehensive, I'll focus on a very brief discussion of some of the major and minor ailments. For example, fever or takwan, which was seen to have been the chief malady, and this term does not occur outside of the Atharva Veda. Many scholars have given the translation referring to this as a malaria fever owing to the symptoms. The fever is addressed and asked to get transferred from the victims to the tribes, and in another case is addressed to find a Dasi girl and strike her with his thunderbolt, probably the high temperature and fever one attends while suffering from this fever. Text also mentions about other ailments like jaundice, for which the rising sun is to be prayed to remove the yellowness of the skin. In this chant, the parrots are being referred to on whom the yellowness is being asked to get transferred, getting removed from the skin of the victim. Besides the importance given to the magical healing and rituals, certain crude implements were also used for undertaking basic surgical procedures along with procedures such as bloodletting. The role of the magical healers or the early physicians was seen as The role of the magical healers or the early physicians was seen as impure in the Atharva Veda, however gradually became important and respected in their profession as physicians in the later medical treatises. Not only did the Vedic people identify the various symptoms and associated them with certain diseases, but they completely believed that these were caused by demonic beings and malignant spirits, and in some cases by the deity's dissatisfaction with the victim. In the case of the latter, they were invoked and worshipped to seek remedies. Sacred utterances and certain esoteric words and phrases became an integral part of the remedial measures along with which the magical religious rituals were performed. Magic became an integral part of the healing process. People started giving importance to such ritualistic healing practices in hope that they could be able to control the fear of the unknown or uncertainty in terms of a disease or even a daily problem. It is quite interesting to note that besides identifying the symptoms and diseases, the Vedic people were also taking account of the observation of certain plants, herbs and trees, scrutinizing and closely studying them. The belief on the magical formulae for the fulfillment of aspirations made the people rely on and have faith. I'll just read. one single life. Magic was becoming synonymous with the transcendent power. As a result, even if these remedies might not have directly benefited their body or helped them cure any ailment, people still attach supreme importance to such explanations and solutions that don't make it.
My paper is titled The Body in the Atharvaveda, Sickness, Madness and Healing. Atharvaveda shows a familiarity with the Indian body, stating verily the head of the Atharva is a god vessel pressed together, breath defends that head, food also mind. This is the translation from Whitney. Scholars using names such as these indicate that the Atharvaveda corpus should be seen as a foundational literature in ancient Indian text on disease treatment and medicine. The Vedic body is seen as a product of penetrative cultural forces and structures of power. It is important to acknowledge the authorship and leadership of the Atharvaveda in order to set preliminary assumptions of the intention of the corpus. The Atharvaveda primarily describes within the ambit of the Brahmanic tradition and therefore consequently the intended leadership of the corpus was Brahmanic. Brahmanic discourse affected the representation of the body which was related to the Brahmanic universe and conception of what was considered good and appropriate for an individual and community as a whole. Brahmanical representation of the body within the Atharvaveda came to exemplify processes by the author of the text to use the body as a means of social control and power. These representations worked as social and religious cues for the Brahmanic society that were used in life practices, and the body itself embodied these representations, especially in event of rituals being conducted. Summarily, the act of writing about the body was an act of molding the body through a larger pedagogy of religion within the constraints of a historical backdrop. The human body becomes a text in itself on which inscriptions of scriptural tradition are documented. It is necessary for us to rehabilitate the Vedic body from writing of Western scholarship on the subject. In the usage of modernist perspective, there is a certain zeophyte tendency that takes place with an undue emphasis that is laid on the idea of science and medicine in correspondence to the body. With this background and juxtaposing the context, we know that the Brahmanic understanding of the Atharvaveda body is more fluid in terms of the lack of zeophytation it shows. In the Atharvaveda, there is a certain latitude with which the body is addressed in terms of identity. The body is regarded as a marker of social identity. The human body is converted to a social body in this way and invests in it a site of location of hierarchized social relationships. In terms of the body and disease, we find that the most nascent concerns with health range from the most anxiety-causing dramatic diseases to the most This suffering takes the form of disease, dreams, and understanding of what is evil in the world. The Atharvaveda's attempt to draw out preoccupation of man with health and being is shown through its fast use of nature to give itself a framework of causality of disease, health, and medicine. This tendency towards naturalism is only a purpose of treatment that is observed to be efficacious. Even so, the treatment does not use nature as a theoretical ground to postulate on human tendencies towards injury, illness or disease. There is a query on substantive nature of the body that closely identifies the body with the mind and further associates the heart with the mind. This is clear from the hymns that deal with jealousy and guilt as afflictions. The physiology of the human body in the Atharvaveda is nuanced, delineating the constitution of the brain in verses that are reflected in the purpose of my text. The different parts of the brain are mapped out. Madness in this text is recognized as an ailment in hymn 111, and the structure of the hymn itself reflects the manner in which the authors choose to engage with madness. The hymns start with a delineation of the physical nature of madness, how it manifests itself, and then finally the causality and the reason for the for madness to manifest itself. The physical manifestation relates to the act of crying out aloud, the loss of restraint, and the idea of being excited. Notionally, this crazy person suffers from an external and exteriority of this madness. The pathology of madness is taught in the excitement of the mind. The madness is, as I previously stated, exterior to the person, brought on to the person. The act of remedying rests solely in the hands of the god. This is made clear in the last section of the hymn. And therefore, healing of disease and madness specifically is considered a real exigency.
Healing is undertaken through charms and mantras in which plants and herbs and specifically amulets are used. The Atharva Veda in its negotiation of illness or madness emerges as a proto-scientific text. This treatise focuses on bodily materialism with the central concern of affectations of the body. The categories of disease and illness affecting the body were drawn out in a religious idiom. However, there is a great bent of naturalism that is propounded in the diseases and illnesses observed. Solutions of healing and management of illnesses sought both religious and naturalistic applications.
Good afternoon, everybody. The title of my paper is The Socio-Cultural and Political Situation in the Easternmost Part of the Gupta Region, Emergent Samadhanar. The area known as Bengal has a rich historiography of being studied in the region. Bengal is identified as a valid regional unit for historical studies due to its location in the Ganga Delta and it being the only one and unique Asamudra Himachala that is stretching from the Himalayas to the sea region in the entire Indian subcontinent. In terms of distinct geological, political and cultural formations, Bengal has been divided into five principal sub-regional variations. Pungravardhana, Raga, Banga, Samatata and Halikela, with Samatata and Halikela lying in the Transmeghna zone within the active delta in the eastern and southeastern sector of the Ganga Delta. Now, before we talk about subregions, it is essential to reckon that a subregion ought not to be seen as a reassemblage of the parts of a broken whole of a region. D.G. Chattopadhyay states that the method of looking into a subregion should begin with the formation of cultural zones, followed by examining the largest spatial formations, like a region it emerged into. He elucidates this through the idea of India or Bharatvarsha, which was basically the constituted whole of a multiple number of janapadas and centers. In a similar methodological tone, it can be supposed that the interaction of localities formed a subregion within and subsequent integration of subregions went into constituting a region. Coming to Samadatta, this subregion lies on the Transmeghna track of the Komila Noakhali plains. I shall try to trace the emergence of Samadatta during 5th and 6th centuries as the formative period which gave a distinct subregional identity to Samadatta. Samadatta appeared in the 4th century seeing the Allahabad pillar inscription of Samudragupta as a frontier Pratyanta state, with the rulers of this area referred to as simply Nripatis, without even having their names mentioned. This points to the fact that these rulers were perhaps merely chiefs of the Gupta sovereign. By defeating Chandravarman, Samudragupta is likely to have conquered parts of the Rara. The formed whole of the Guptas over Pundravardhana Bhukti in northern Bengal is also evident from about 12 Gupta copper plates ranging in date from around 113 to 224 Gupta era. However, the gradual penetration of the Gupta power in the Ganga Delta requires a re-examination in the light of the newly discovered charter of 184 Gupta era and the Gunaikar copper plate of 188 Gupta era, both issued by Vainagupta from Samadatta. Vainagupta's epithet suggests that he was a preeminent subordinate ruler, Maharaja, paying allegiance to his Gupta overlord, Paramparaka. The recently edited 184 Gupta era record of Vainagupta from Samadatta records 29 instances of the purchase of clocks, first purchased from their respective owners and then gifted to the Aditya Sangha. The record states that it was a reissue of an earlier grant, which had been made in 91 Gupta era by a local ruler of Samadatta named Nathachandra. This means that Gupta power penetrated Samadatta by early 5th century CE. So far, while we know that the earliest Gupta land grant from the area was supposed to be Manaidaha copper plate from Pundravardhana, now we know that the earliest land grant precedes the Pundravardhana and comes from the sub-region of Samadatta. The record of 91 Gupta era speaks volume on the socio-economic milieu of Samadatta. Firstly, the record notes the earliest instance of double transfer of land of the same flock, first by sale and then by death. This clearly demonstrates a mature sense of individual proprietary rights, which was clearly recognized as the sale and purchase of land was made through cash. This is a unique feature of the Gupta land grants in Bengal, not seen in Wales. The earliest mention of dinara in a Gupta copper plate is encountered in this grant. Dinara was a unit of gold coin widely circulated under the Gupta regime and mentioned in contemporary copper plate inscriptions from North Bengal. The use of dinara suggests the existence of a money-based economy with strong purchasing capacity in Samadatta. Secondly, the preference for institutional land grants in Samadatta is further accentuated by this grant. The record of 91 Gupta era exhibits that the Ajivika Sangha owned the landed property as an institutional entity. This is the earliest known instance of institutional land grant in the history of Bengal, which continued till 7th century CE. Thirdly, the 184 Gupta era record of Vainagupta voices about the owners of land, while the land record records in general demonstrate that Brahmanas were premier landholders. This copper plate of 91 Gupta era records a large number of non-Brahmanas basically artisans who sold lands. The landowners from whom land was brought had names often suffixed with Karmantika, Shreshthi, Bilala, which suggests professional groups had substantial landholdings. It is noticeable that there were personal names ending with Bangala. The term Bangala stands for southern or coastal tracts of Bangal. This might mean that some people from Bangal region were migrating to Samarata. And that also implies that Samarata was becoming an area of attraction for people in neighboring regions. The record of 91 Gupta era and also the 188 Gupta era illuminates the complex religious and cultural fabric of Samarata. First, while in 184 Gupta era, it's the earliest epigraphic record of gift of land to the Aditya Sangha by Vainda Gupta, who was actually a tribal ruler, Parama Maheshwara. The record of 188 Gupta era by the same ruler shows him gifting land to a Buddhist monastery. Secondly, 188 Gupta era plate mentions Abhayavartika Sangha of the Mahayana for the first time, which is actually difficult to trace in Buddhist works. So it is interesting to note that in the far eastern corner of the Indian subcontinent, Mahayana Buddhism flourished under a broad patronage of a tribal ruler. Thirdly, the boundary markers suggest a complex religious and cultural composition of the area of Junagadh. Studying them, we see that Buddhists, Ajivikas and Vaishnavites cohabited in the same place, implying the cultural complexity and plurality in Junagadh and Samarata. Talking about the political fabric of Samarata, the 91 Gupta era record illuminates that there is no powerful mention of a regional administrator like an Uparika or Uparika Maharaja in Samarata. This inscription illuminates certain similarities in the designations of a few high-ranking functionaries encountered in the Ganga Valley. It also explicitly mentions. Also, the military prowess of the local authorities strongly accentuated in this Vainagupta's branch. Because his record also states his command over the riverine flotilla, elephant and cavalry forts. This record also highlights the possibility of the existence of a well-organized bureaucratic system of efficient record-keeping practice of land transactions. So the foregoing assessment of the socio-cultural and political milieu of the sub-region of Samarata in the light of the recently discovered 91 Gupta era copper plate record has challenged some of the well-established notions and established a fresh understanding of early Bengal as a region. Two crucial instances from the 7th century CE are to be noted, which further underlines the distinct sub-regional profile acquired by Samarata by them. First, the use of the epithet Samatateshwara by Sridharna Ratha of the Ratha dynasty, which indicates that the Ratha realm under him had strong local roots and perhaps grew from within. And second, the specific mention of the country of Samhotaka by Xuanzang, which was on the seaside territories characterized by low topography and moist soil. This suggests that Samarata, within a span of 3 centuries, marked its emergence in the Transmeghna zone in the eastern part of the Ganga Delta from a present state in the Allahabad pillar inscription of the 4th century CE to a sub-regional identity by the 7th century CE.
And it's a long thing, but I try to summarize it in the shortest possible term. The title is Pattern of Rural Settlement and Distribution of Resources in the Early Medieval South Central Region of Rajasthan from 87th century to 82nd century. Now, the writing on early medieval rural settlement and society seems to suffer from curious contradictions. While several generalizations about them have been offered in works which generally relates to agrarian history, yet an exhaustive work on rural settlement with its varied ramifications for larger historical processes is still a reality. Most of our understanding about rural settlement is largely derived from generalizations which are incidental part of the vast and variegated studies on economic, social and at times on administrative history. Following some of the recent work on rural settlement, however, there is an increasing realization among historians of the necessity to take up research on rural settlement not only to understand the agrarian economy but also the nature of rural society and the power structure that existed at a given point of time. It is also being realized that the study of rural settlement with its varied ramification may also provide us a better understanding of the larger historical processes at work during the period of early medieval India. This has led to a fresh spate of research on settlement, including the rural one, in various regional contexts. However, as far as the region of Rajasthan is concerned, the historiography on early medieval rural settlement has still not acquired the momentum it should have, considering the richness of epigraphic data that is available in the context of this region. The present paper, therefore, may be treated as a modest attempt to fill the gap between that exists in the historiography of rural settlement in the context of Rajasthan. The study would be based on the select donated inscriptions ranging in time from 87th century to 812th century, relating to the segment of the space which is designated as Mewar. The study set out to explore, on the basis of information contained in the donative inscription, aspects of rural setting and society of the region under consideration. It would focus on the reconstruction of the pattern of the spatial distribution of rural settlement and the relationship of one settlement unit with another, the way the resources, especially water resources, were distributed and organized in rural landscape, and the extent and level of control they exercised over them. The exercise would also try to bring out as to how settlements were organized socially and the way they were located in the given authority structure, especially in matter of transfer of resources of rural settlement. Embedded in this would also be an attempt to interrogate how far generalization made about them in recent history were on rural settlement, especially in the context of early medieval India and the stereotypic notion about them, which largely flows from the conventional historiography hold good in the context of early medieval Rajasthan. We will start the discussion by citing the detail of the land charter that was issued by Bhakta, who was the subordinate ruler of the Gohila dynasty, with its center of authority located at a place called Kiskindapur. This charter was issued in 8688 from Kiskindapur. Though the precise geographical location of the object of donation mentioned in the charter is still uncertain, it is likely, it was situated somewhere around Kiskindapur. The property transferred through the charter to five Brahmins consisted of two plots of land that shaped, which were situated near the eastern border of the village, which seemed to have been formed a part of another larger unit, which again was located there in Vishaya. The first plot of the land belonged to Pahaka and Pavaka and consisted of five strand measure of land. The second plot consisted of land around a well, Gopar, which was in the possession of certain persons, including Gopar. Apart from stating the geographical location of both the pieces of land in general term, the charter goes on to describe their boundary and also furnishes the list of variety of people, both official as well as non-official, involved in the process of transfer of landed property. These details about boundary specification and the list of people involved in the entire process of transfer reveals several aspects of agrarian economy and society of the place under discussion. As to the boundaries and specification of the first piece of land, the charter tells us that it was bounded in the east and south by an embankment linking it with the lower part of Mitrapalika Gram, while its west lay a reservoir of drinking water belonging to Rangarang, and part of the embankment of the tank belonged to Pahaka. To the north of the plot, there was a path leading to the wood of Sakapalli and Sodhana. About the second plot of land, it is stated that it is to the east, and it was to the east was located a Sedhaka, possibly a tree, in the marshy land belonging to Blacksmith, and to its south was another Sedhaka standing on the main road of the district but belonging to the plot. In the west and north, the plot was bounded by the field belonging to Madhav Kachar. The charter also carries the list of addresses to the grant, which starts with those who were apparently part of administrative apparatus, and the list is rather long. The list does not end there. It also refers to those who were part of the state apparatus and possibly represented the village community. It consisted of agriculturist houses, householders, as well as people of the area in question, headed by the merchant of the Brahmins and also the Karnikas, the member of the scribe community. What is noteworthy is the fact that despite an overwhelming presence of the representative of the state apparatus in the charter, none of them were involved in the process of demarcation of the boundaries of either piece of land. On the other, we are told that the job of demarcating the boundary was carried out by persons who seem not to have been part of the state apparatus at all. The charter tells us that it was individuals such as Usara, Paheka, Mahata, Sangilika, along with others whose names are not mentioned, who determined the boundary of the donated piece of land. Before we turn to discuss another donative inscription, let us briefly summarize some of the important points that emerges out of this detailed discussion. I will just take the listeners come through and
Which have important bearing on the understanding of rural society and economy of the place under conservation. To begin with, charter clearly indicates that a variety of irrigation devices which was in use in this area, what is important is the fact that majority of the irrigation devices were owned by individuals who probably belonged to the village referred to in the charter. These irrigation devices did not exist merely as an irrigation devices in the rural space. Their frequent reference to the context of the boundary specification also points to the fact that they were perceived as an important landmarker in rural space and as an important marker of agrarian space by the member of the local community. Another significant point emerging out of the details is the manner in which the state and the rural society interacted with each other in the matter of property transfer. The charter indicates that the member of village community exercised considerable authority in matter of property transfer even though they were located within the larger state structure. There are several other inscriptions which I have discussed. I'll just give you the conclusion conclusion which is a little interesting because it breaks many of the stereotypes about the rural settlement. To sum up, one would like to put forward few points emerging out of the discussion made above about rural settlement the society of Mewar in the form of concluding remarks. To begin with, the distribution pattern of rural settlement in the region seems to have followed what may be described as the nucleated pattern, and if the detail contained in the charter issued by Bhavakta and the Dabuk inscriptions are for any indication, this also seems to have been the case with the distribution agricultural field. The detailed discussion above also indicates that rural settlement, at least in the region under consideration, did not exist as a physical isolate, as has often been assumed, apart from the fact that the boundary of one rural settlement were invariably defined in terms of other settlements. The reference to path leading to the wood at Sakalapalli and Sodana, as well as the road leading to Vishaya in the grant of Bhavata, referring to hut mark in the book inscription, and the occurrence of reference to variegated street and road in the Ghatiyala inscriptions are indication that the rural settlement and society did not exist in isolation with closed economy as has been assumed by the proponents of Indian feudal model. Rather, they existed as a part of larger network which consisted of variety of settlements with a varied economic orientation. Though our charter do not give us conclusive proof to settle the issue of whether the village community existed outside, inside or outside of existing political structure, what they definitely tells us that they did not stand at a distance from each other. The reference to the involvement of member of village community in different capacity at different level in the event of transfer of resources is indicative of the fact that it was considered to be important enough by the donor, irrespective of whatever his authority status might have been, to take the member of village community in confidence. This is indicative of the control of village community which they exercise over its resources. Thus, many of the generalization about rural settlement, such as self-sufficient unit of production or as a passive physical unit in a space, or their existence as little republic, or various constructs about them embedded in the construct of oriental despotism, also certainly do not hold good in the context of rural settlement and society. Having briefly introduced upon few points about rural settlement society and the sources of early Mewar, one would like to end the discussion with a note of caution by confessing that the select land title which constitute the source material for the paper are inadequate for offering generalization which would apply to early medieval rural settlement of Rajasthan. In fact, the objective of the empirical study is not to offer generalization at this stage. What one intends to do through this exercise is to indicate that the land charter, which have been used extensively to construct a dynastic history or even some social formation, can also be exploited to construct several other aspects of rural settlement society, the writing on which remains marginal to the historiography of Rajasthan in general and of region in particular. Thank you.
The title of my paper is The Image of the Hindu Buddha, an analysis of how the image of Buddha in the nation of Vishnu evolved through texts and the corresponding images. The Buddha is seen as an author of
that Prasad Yashi Mishra Memorial Lecture will be given at 6 p.m. by Professor Aditya Mukherjee. So, you all give me that question to some. Thank you.
The Buddha is seen as an avatar of Vishnu by many Hindus. The idea of an independent Buddhist religion existing in India, which was once the chief rival to Brahmanical religion, though familiar in historical studies, is not present in the mind of ordinary Indians. Ramana traditions like Buddhism and Jainism are seen to be offshoots of Brahmanical religion as reformist movements. The Buddha in the Dashavatara mentioned is therefore in conformity with this view. My focus is on the depiction of the Buddha as an incarnation of Vishnu, which was mostly done in the second half of the first millennium CE. But at the same time as the mutation and later decline of Buddhism started. I will try to deconstruct the complexities which went into the formation and implication of as pervading a Brahmanical religious concept as the Dashavatara, which has a principal figure of another religion, Buddhism, as an incarnation of a principal god of its own pantheon. Although this question could be answered through various means, I will look primarily into the text and of the period under consideration, both religious and secular. We have references of some earlier forms of avatars in texts as early as the Vedic corpus, such as the mention of Vishnu traveling three steps in the universe, which later became part of the Sri Vikrama. The Satapatha Brahmana mentions prior to the incarnation as Varaha. The Puranas, Hindu Puranas said that Vishnu incarnates for the good of the world when unrighteousness prevails. The 10 most commonly accepted and recognized avatars of Vishnu are Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narasimha, Vamana, including Sri Vikrama, Parashurama, Raghurama, Krishna, Buddha and Kalki. The Shavatara list is not rigid and has various variations across Puranas. Sometimes Buddha is replaced by other personages in place of ninth avatar, either by replacement by name such as Jina in Vishnu Purana, or by reordering of the sequence, mostly Buddha forming the second last avatar before Kalki in the avatara list, which are larger than 10. Of the 21 Mahapuranas that can be identified, Buddha is directly or indirectly mentioned in all except the Markandeya Purana and Vamana Purana. The word Buddha or Bodha or any related word mostly were used universally to denote any anti-Vedic doctrine by the Puranas. Some such examples showing different versions of the reason of incarnation are given below. In Bhagavata Purana, it says, then after the Kali age here begins, a person named Buddha, son of Anjana, will be born among the Kikadas in the region is thought to be near Gaya in order to delude the enemies of the god. The Agni Purana says that the Asuras, having defeated in battle by the Asuras, sought the protection of Vishnu. He in consequence was born as the deluder in the form of Buddha, the son of Jina. By him the Asuras were deceived, who on being induced to abandon the religion of the Vedas, lost all power as warriors. From that time has the religion of Buddha flourished. And many are the heretics who have forsaken the sacred ordinance of Vedas. Later works like the Dasavatara Charitra of Kshemendra and Gita Govinda of Jayadeva regard him as an incarnation of mercy who came to teach the people of essential purity of animal sacrifices. Observations about the inclusion of Buddha in the Brahmanical Dasavataras are also found in Buddhist texts, like Sankara Swami in his Devati Saya Stotra to the time of King Kanishka. I'll skip the two parts. We see that different sections of the Brahmin school sometimes muted, implicitly or explicitly accepted the avatara doctrine. However, when and how and why the Buddha, the principal figure of their main adversary faith, predominantly came to be regarded as an avatar of remains to be investigated. These debates, along with their sites and people involved, need to be placed and be seen if they are relative to the concurrent Dashavatara imagery of the region. Thank you.
Good afternoon everyone. The title of my paper is Transcending Conventional Perceptions, Exploring Role Play in the Natya Shastra and the Kama Sutra. Investigating the Natya Shastra and the Kama Sutra, this paper will delineate the roles prescribed for women and men in the world of performance, which seems to have emerged as a fluid space where social identities were swapped. This paper will explore how by way of performance, women and men transcend their abiding social identities. I further examine the interchangeability of gender roles that the text consider possible, where in drama the possibility of women donning the role of a man and a man donning the role of a woman is also needed.
Of course, such deconstructions of gender roles remain incomplete without an examination of the otherwise normative roles ascribed to men and women, which is acknowledged in this paper. As far as the texts are concerned, both these texts claim Shastric status and have been attributed to a single author. However, in all likelihood, the works were composite, written by multiple authors, a feature typically associated with Sanskrit texts. Bharata's Natyashastra is a theoretical treatise on the craft of dramaturgy, roughly dated to the 2nd century CE, whereas the Kama Sutra is ascribed to Vatsyayana and contains a detailed discussion on erotic desire and is placed between 2nd and 4th century CE. So moving to the first section, the roles prescribed for women and men in drama. In drama, roles were usually assigned to the appropriate obvious gender, but transvestite roles are also considered possible in the Natyashastra. Bharat lays emphasis on the personality and the physical type of the individual while assigning the roles. When the role is assigned to a player, the method of selection is not to look at the caste or class of performers. A detailed description of who is supposed to assume the role of gods, demons, kings is further explored. Where a player playing the role of gods is supposed to have well-defined limbs, the ones playing the role of a king should have a good voice and a good appearance and was supposed to be pleasant to the sight. Therefore, a critical inquiry suggests the construction of social exclusions and inclusions based on physical handicaps, where players with physical deformity were not supposed to be assigned a part in the drama. For someone who was supposed to be given the role of a Rakshasa, Danava or Daitya, a person should possess a fat, tall body, voice like the peal of thunder, furious looking eyes and well-knit eyebrows. Hence, the male characters were supposed to be fitting to the masculine type. What distinguished the actor from the rest of the crew were their bright attire, natural grace of limbs, experience in witnessing the performances on stage, knowledge of shastras and expertise in representing various roles of characters. What lifted up the heart of histrionics for the Nata was his ability to play different roles and his ability to imitate different people, including ladies. Even in the distribution of roles to female performers, there is no emphasis on a caste or class, but just on her histrionic talents. When we examine the ideal features that performers were supposed to possess, the emphasis is more apparent on physical features. However, when the role of the servant is given to an actor, one of the prerequisites is low birth. The text is silent about the caste of performers playing the roles of kings, gods and others. However, the text again specifies that if such ideal characters are unavailable, anybody who is considered suitable for the role could be selected and offered the part, suggesting flexibility in the mode of selection. When the roles are distributed, the incorporation of Natyadharmi dramatic conventions is extremely significant and it's particularly significant as it suggests how a person who's poor was given the space to play the part of a king with the aid of makeup and costume. Incidentally, such a person would also have known Sanskrit. Sanskrit verse was associated with men and it was also symbolic of the hierarchy within the universe of men, as it wasn't available to men of the lower status. Therefore, going back to my argument of control access to the Sanskrit language, what must be taken note of is that if we are to assume that the role of a king was supposed to be played by someone from the lower rung of the society, then the debate of restriction of Sanskrit to the elites of society is at some level challenged. Moving on to a discussion on interchangeability of gender roles, the possibility of a temporary exchange of identity in terms of gender roles is suggested both in the Natyashastra and the Kama Sutra. In the Natyashastra, there are three possibilities where men and women could don each other's role. Anurupa, Virupa and Rupanusarini. I'm not elaborating on that for lack of time. It is interesting to note that the text recognizes the possibility of cross-dressing, where women could don the roles of males in temples, palaces of kings, residences of commanders of armies in a dramatic performance. And in this performance where she cross-dresses, she is supposed to shed her natural grace in order to get into the character of a man. While in the earlier section, I argued how the text is subtly constructing feminine and masculine identities, one notices a subtle contestation of creation of such rigid gender identities as far as role play is concerned. In terms of sensual pleasure, it has been stated in the Kama Sutra that men experience higher sensual pleasure if the woman plays the man's part. This interchangeability of roles during the act suggests that there existed a space where the norms were altered and was even recognized in the normative text on pleasure, therefore complicating the notion of identity and alterity in terms of gender relations.
Hence, the context in which the these genders transcend their roles and assume that of another gender has been drawn attention to. I bear in mind the make-believe and temporary nature of such exchange of identities. However, it remains extremely significant that there existed such non-patriarchal possibilities in a society where such exchange of identities wasn't considered possible in the traditional patriarchal representation of women and men. What I would also like to argue is that in drama, the aspect of role play allowed the players to transcend their abiding social identity. Thus, theatre in this sense allows for a short-lived critique of the outside world. Furthermore, we notice a complex construction of masculine and feminine identities, especially in terms of interchangeability, and which suggests these categories cannot be treated as established. Thus, I suggest that the theatrical arena emerged as a fluid space in comparison to and irrespective of the social world outside, where identities could be exchanged momentarily. I also emphasize through this paper that by using the strategy of role play, both in the realm of performance and pleasure respectively, social relations were represented from diverse perspectives, making it more complex and less rigid. Thank you.
I am Dr. Priyadarshi Puragare, and my title is Depiction of Buddhist Symbol and Their Worshipping Non-Form of Agri Buddhist Art. In Agri Buddhist Art, the depiction of Buddhist Symbol non-form is the period of Ashoka, and depiction on the forum of Pati, the capital of the elephant killer worshipping by people are shown. The earliest representation of Buddha are symbolical. The symbol employed always including a pair of feet also. The lotus, elephant, horse, lion and wheel of the period depicted in various decoration of stupa, torana and vedika decorated by these symbols, with some symbols like stupa, lion throne or sinhasana, dharma chakra or wheel of dharma, bodhi tree or vrikshatetya, ushnisha, triratna, swastika, feet, flaming, pillar, deer and other. The worshipping of these symbols were more popular and they depicted in the form of worshipping by yogis. The depiction of worshipping Buddhist symbols known from Bharut, Sachi, Sangol, Amravati, Oni and other places. I am not going in detail, but in Kushana period also, when the Buddha image are in the worshipping, the Kushana period, the worshipping of Buddha image was started and completed. But one depiction of Dharma Chakra worshipping known in the on the pedestal of standing Buddha. On the other side, the standard Dharma Chakra, there are standing figures of male and female devotees carrying bunches of flowers in their right hand. The male figures are standing on right hand, right side, and the female on the left side of the chakra. Among the devotees, four children are seen with folded hands. The males are wearing long coats with waist belts, trousers, while the females are in tunics. The foreign dress segment of the body of figures, characters of the script, mean point of the belonging of the Kushan period. Conclusion, the large number worshipping depiction of Buddhist symbols shows the popularity of symbols worshipping by followers and also devotees. Thank you.